It's a beautiful afternoon for football here in Conway, South Carolina. We're right by the beach, and today you check out the surf turf at Coastal. The Runnin Bulldogs and the 8th-ranked Chanticleers are live on the American Sports Network. And hello, everybody. Evan Lepler alongside the legendary College Football Hall of Fame coach Jim Donnan. Great to have you with us on ASN. And coach, this Coastal team was number one in the nation, but slipped up last week and now in an unfamiliar position trying to bounce back from a rare defeat.
Well, we used to talk to our teams about Fido. That meant we were going to forget it and drive on. And I really believe this football team understands, with everything hanging in the balance, they got to get a W today.
And it's very important because they feel they cannot afford another loss and still advance to the FCS playoffs. This Gardner Webb team in a different position. A year ago, they didn't win a Big South game. Now they've won two.
Yeah, I've been impressed with this team and the way they've developed. With a really good offense that supplements their defense. We're going to see a power running football team today that really takes it to the defense, and their defense very aggressive, the kind that can give Coastal some trouble.
Well, that defense is going to have its hands full today because of Coastal Carolina's offense and Alex Ross, the QB, 33-3 in the last 36 games against FCS opponents. And Alex Ross, a huge reason why. He's playing a little hurt, but you've watched him on film. You've tutored great quarterbacks all your life. What are the key characteristics of Alex Ross?
Well, he got my attention when I saw right off the bat that he had over 10,000 yards running and passing. And we'll see in some of these different type of releases that he has, a very good release. He's got good touch, and we're going to have to worry about his protection today, because as you mentioned, he's had a little trouble with his ankle, but very gutty performance last week. And just the fact that he's back out there shows what he means to this football team.
And he's run for a bunch of touchdowns, but still looking for his first passing touchdown in conference play. The other passer, well, he's more of a runner too. Tyrell Maxwell, he's the quarterback, but he's led the Runnin Bulldogs in rushing every game he's played this year.
Well, he's a very athletic guy, and we're going to see throughout the day that he's going to be more of a runner than a passer. He's got good stats. He does a good job running the attack. As the season has progressed and as his career has progressed, he's shown a lot of leadership to go with his running ability. I look for him to hit some pretty good shots today on the play-action pass, and can't wait to see how he operates on the edge. This is an outstanding young quarterback.
Well, this Gardner Webb football team has won twice here in Conway. They've never beaten Coastal at home, but they have beaten them twice here at Brooks Stadium. And Carroll McRae, the honor of coaching at his alma mater, something that many students probably aspire to. He was an offensive lineman. He'll be the first to tell you he wasn't a very good college football player, but he is trying to turn this football program around, and a win today would be a huge, giant step in that direction. Coastal Carolina, of course, led by the chairman of TD Ameritrade, the businessman who used to be a football coach and then became a football coach again, Joe Moglia, looking for his 40th win as Coastal Carolina's head coach today. Look at that. Picture perfect conditions under the sun here in the Palmetto State. There's Joe Moglia. He had an offer to be the defensive coordinator at the University of Miami a lifetime ago, but he passed it up to enter the business world. He is back, and he had a busy week in the media. He was on the Dan Levitard show earlier in the week. He was featured on Showtime's 60 Minute Sports in a nice segment. Gardner Webb will kick off. The Chanticleers will touch the football first, and there is the ever dangerous Devin Brown, the Big South career leader in kickoff return touchdowns. You wonder if Gardner Webb will even bother kicking the ball in his direction. Coastal Carolina looking for their 8th win of the year, and it's very important. It's a little chip shot kick from Paul Schumacher. And this is one of the up men, Ray Lewis III, who gets hammered. Did not go down, and now he does at the 25-yard line, and that's where Alex Ross will lead the Chanticleer offense onto the field. This is the 37th start for Alex Ross. He's 31 and 6 all time as the starter.
He's had a lot of reps as a quarterback. He's run this system ever since he's got on campus, and they got a really good job of mixing up the run and pass. They do a lot at the line of scrimmage, puts a lot of decision making right in Alex's wheelhouse.
And he's got no one with him in the backfield on this opening play from the 25. The ankle looks okay as he slides across the 30. This Gardner Webb defense coach really has a tough test today, but the Runnin Bulldogs front seven is really strong, led by this guy. The numbers may not blow you away, but the opportunities he creates for his teammates as the nose tackle is what's important to note.
Well, he takes up a lot of space, can make a lot of plays, and they better take care of this guy because he can create a lot of havoc for the defense.
Here's D'Angelo Hop Henderson. Over 3,000 yards rushing in his career, and he's close to a first down.
Tempo is a big part of this coastal offense. Sometimes they come out and run really quick plays. Other times they look to the sideline for check off one play or the other. But when you got an experienced quarterback like Alex Ross, he knows what to get them in and gets them in there pretty quickly.
Coach, what do you think of this teal turf?
It's definitely different. I wore my shoes to match it today. Nobody really mentioned it except you, but I got some good teal Nikes on.
Yes, you do. Ross launches deep down the middle. It should have been picked off. Trey Lucas may have lost it in the sun.
Sun's going to be a big factor here early. It's right in our eyes, and I'm sure it's bothering the players. But I think, Ross not being able to practice full speed, that's a good example right there for us, Evan. The fact they weren't able to really get his feet under him, and we're going to see this young man all day. What a tremendous back, and he's going to break a long run before this game's over with. What a tremendous player.
It's a redshirt junior, already graduated. He's working on a master's degree. Ross looking a little ginger as he gains a couple.
You know, you can practice with a gimpy ankle all week and feel like it's going to be all right, but once you get out there and start getting hit a little bit and moving around, it'll definitely help Ross. I don't think it's the kind that's going to plague him and keep him from being as good as he needs to. We talked about D'Angelo Henderson before, but we'll give him a little more plug again. That this guy's a touchdown in 22 consecutive games is pretty impressive. Plus, he's the fifth player in Big South history with 3,000 career rushing yards.
Crossed very over impressive. That plateau last week on third and eight. Ross. And he is shy of the first down. Good tackle there by Thomas Adams. So an interesting early decision for Joe Moglia on fourth and about one.
This is the situation with all spread teams. You're not used to being under center. And when you got to make a foot or half a foot and you're backed up, it's very difficult to get that against a penetrating defense like the Runnin Bulldogs. I like this call. I think it's a good idea to punt. Make this other team prove, that they can move the football on you. The Runnin Bulldogs have had trouble all year getting started.
Left-footed punt is short. The punter, Evan Rabin, has only had one punt returned all season. That was his 22nd punt. Well, one first down. And then a punt. Joe Moglia's team fails to score on its opening possession. The Runnin Bulldogs have the ball when we come back to Conway.
Thank you.
We're scoreless in the opening quarter. Gardner Webb with the football for the first time out of the break. Here at Brooks Stadium, the Runnin Bulldogs have won a couple of times, but for the most part, Coastal Carolina has had a lot of success. And it's a new look with the teal turf this year. A $1.2 million budget to renovate this facility, and they'll have even more renovations coming in the next couple of years to add perhaps 10,000 seats or so to this facility. So here's Tyrell Maxwell, and he hands it off. And a short 4-yard gain. Ball carrier Elijah Perry, a freshman.
You know, one of the good things about running a spread attack is you got different ways to attack the perimeter. And using a guy in motion really gives you a two-back look. And that time, Maxwell did a good job of reading the inside backer and did a good job making the proper read.
The give to Jonathan Blackman. He's tripped up by a lunging lineman.
Right off the bat here today, we're seeing this Runnin Bulldog team come off the football. Their offensive line getting some really good movement at the point of attack, and we'll get a good shot at what Maxwell's done on the year. Has been pretty efficient as a passer, a little bit better as a runner, but he's got to get that average up a little bit and also get more yards per completion.
Fresh set of downs for the Runnin Bulldogs. Maxwell lost the football. He recovers, but that is an 8-yard loss. Well, the question we had about Gardner Webb today, Coach, would they be able to move the football consistently? The offense has struggled throughout the year. Calvin Hollenhorst that time knocking the football loose.
Yeah, you like the fact that Calvin Hollenhorst played his assignment there. A lot of times defensive ends crash down on that type of action by the quarterback, but he not only contained Maxwell, he did a good job of taking the ball away.
Second and 18, and Maxwell's gonna burn a timeout. This is just his 8th career start as the quarterback for the Runnin Bulldogs. He missed the game in September against Virginia Union. He threw the ball well against Liberty, 10 of 14. He showed you his numbers against South Alabama, an FBS opponent that he really played well against. He's shown glimpses of being great. He's an athlete. He was a defensive back recruit. Could have played at Georgia Tech or Missouri as a defensive back. He was offered, but got really the urge to play QB. So here he is at Gardner Webb.
Yeah, and he's developing, as we talked about in the opening. Everything's ahead of him, but you know, they got a really good first down on their first possession there. And then all of a sudden on their second time out here, trying to run the quarterback option out on the outside, he gets a lost yardage play. When you get lost yardage plays at any level and you're a running team, it's really hard to come back on second and third and long because they're just not used to pass protecting like you got to do in this situation.
Coastal Carolina has made some personnel adjustments to the defense today. Short pass complete here. Gain 6.
You know, one of the things you need to do, Evan, when you got second long or third long is find a way to get the ball, get half of it. And that time Lee did a really good job of finding an opening in the defense and picked up, you know, a marginal amount of yardage. But this is a lot better for this young quarterback. Third and 12 is a lot better than third and 20.
Adonis Lee with the reception. Spread out offense here for Gardner Webb. Bernard flanking Maxwell in the backfield. Maxwell steps up and he takes off. He made a man miss, but he's 3 yards shy of the marker to gain. Coastal Carolina's secondary with a different look today. Michael Billings and Austin Murillo getting starts in the place of Kieran Johnson and Kelvin DeVoe. Coastal Carolina's also been playing more of a 2-deep throughout the season, but today mixing that up, playing a stronger safety closer to the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, and that possession right there, they played a spy on Maxwell, and a really good job of, by C.J. Thompson making the play.
Low line drive, punt angled to the sideline off the foot of Andrew Komornik. You said 22 punts isn't that many for Coastal. That was Komornik's 59th punt of the season. That sort of tells the story of these two teams.
Yeah, he's usually a lot more dependable than that. But, you know, once in a while you get that kind of situation as a punter where you, the sun's in your eyes, you don't look it on your foot, you miss it, and that's exactly what happened there. We'll be back in just a second.
We are scoreless in the first quarter, 8:56 to go in the opening 15 here at Brooks Stadium. Follow your high school team live with ASN and ScoreStream. Just download the free ScoreStream app to get real-time scores, photos, video, chat, and more. Follow prep sports like never before with ScoreStream. So each team with one first down and then a kick on the opening possession. Evan Lepler with the legendary Georgia Bulldogs and Marshall Thundering Herd coach Jim Donnan. Here's Alex Ross, a draw. Henderson known for that shifty spin, and he's got some room down the sidelines. It's a first down to the 45.
Kind of delayed draw, and as you mentioned, that's kind of his trademark. He's got that spin, and he kind of sets the defender up. Here we go, and spin out of it, and then shows the kind of speed that you got to have as many career rushing yards as this guy's got, and big first down pickup.
Trey Lucas pushed him out of bounds. Gain of 15 for Hop Henderson. And there's a running Bulldog down on the field. Ivan Toomer, the veteran cornerback, preseason all Big South, one of the guys that they rely on in the secondary. That would be a huge loss for Randall McCray's defense. And this Gardner Webb defense has been impressive, especially on big plays. They're number 5 in all of FCS in terms of third down defense. Their red zone defense has been excellent, stingy near the goal line, and the defense has kept them in a lot of games.
Yeah, it really has. And one of the things in preparing for a good back like this, it's hard to simulate and practice the kind of moves that Henderson presents. So when you got a chance to tackle a scout team back, you really don't think about it much. But then all of a sudden, you see the kind of moves and the quickness that he showed on that run. And it's got everybody's attention, including mine right now, the burst that this young man has. And you got to be ready. You got to break down. And when you got a chance to make a play against a really explosive offense like this, you can't miss tackles. And let's watch throughout the day how many missed tackles we see We saw one early there by the Coastal. When they had a chance to make a play, they made it. The young guy there, Calvin Hollenhorst, number 58, did a really good job on Maxwell.
So they check on Ivan Toomer. We encourage all fans to join the conversation on Twitter, Facebook, and on Instagram. Hashtag Social Saturday is where it's at. For college football fans, at Live on ASN, your home for social for the American Sports Network. Decent assortment of red t-shirts and apparel in the stands, but much more teal than anything here in Conway. Coastal Carolina has a busy finish to the season. They play Kennesaw State here next Saturday, and then 5 days later, they are at Liberty. And you know, we were asking folks around the program, you're eighth in the nation now. Do you think you can, you know, drop one more and still get in the big dance, which is, you know, Selection Sunday, 15 days away? And the consensus seems to be no.
Well, you know, there's a lot of teams around the country that are vying for these spots. And, you know, each conference is going to get their one. And then sometimes you get one other, maybe another one. But three from one conference, as small as this one is, I just don't see it. But they've got a really good tradition around the country. Everybody knows what kind of football team they have. And everybody's going to get beaten once in a while. But, you know, that was a big win for Charleston Southern last week. They really deserved to win. They played extremely well.
Yes, they absolutely did. Buccaneers prevailing 33-25 in the low country. Toomer off the field. They throw on first down and into Runnin Bulldog territory. That's Bruce Mapp, junior from Philly. Their leading receiver, that's his 38th catch of the year, and I'll have to sit out of play after losing his helmet.
You like the fact that right away they go after the new guy in the game and they just throw a little hitch route, but a big first down pickup of 8 yards and really opens up a lot of things for him to go against this Runnin Bulldog defense.
It's DJ Allen, a redshirt freshman, transferred from Dodge City Community College to Gardner Webb, replacing Toomer on that outside cornerback spot. The pitch to Henderson makes a couple men miss, and another first down.
Yeah, you really like the way that Ross attacks the defensive end on the speed option. There's no fake at all here. He just takes the ball right at the inside shoulder, dishes it out. Really good blocking on the perimeter by Mapp, who sets up with a really good block here. They crack back on a linebacker who's illegal. The refs miss it. You can't block below the waist there. So got to get on the refs one at a time, once in a while.
You never did that when you were coaching, though.
Just as soon as we got off the bus.
Throw across the middle, Craig Wyke. Gardner Webb missed a bunch of tackles on these first couple of drives. Another solid gain to the 21.
Well, a good inside receiver knows where to sit down in the defenses, and White does exactly what he needs to there. He doesn't run but too far away from the linebackers and sets down, presents his numbers, and really good throw by Ross.
They called it another first down. Henderson tripped up from behind. That time O.J. Mao got a piece of the ankle.
Seeing different ways to get the ball to an outstanding back. We saw him run the speed option and show his speed on the perimeter, and that was just kind of delayed counter play, pulling the guard. And even though it picked up just a couple yards, it slows the defense down when you run the counter.
Now it's the backup, Oshamar Abercrombie, alongside Ross in the backfield. And Abercrombie takes it. A good push from the offensive line. Mostly a rebuilt offensive line after losing three longtime starters from a year ago. Going right up the middle, and O.J. Mao.
Boy, you just see the kind of strength that O.J. has. He just sheds the blocker, gets off the center pretty quick, and here we go for six.
There's Abercrombie from the 14-yard line right up the gut for the score.
Can't blink your eyes with this fast-paced offense by the Coastal, and they're doing a good job of attacking this Runnin Bulldog defense. Put in a fresh back in Abercrombie. He knew what to do with it, and big score for them. They run what we call the swinging gate here. Look at all the different people there. If they feel like they got a chance to go for two, they'll go on and snap it. Looks like they're thinking about it here.
They do. It's Abercrombie, and he powers through the arms of the would-be tackler for the two-point conversion. Just like last week, Coastal Carolina leads 8-0, and Oshamar Abercrombie has all 8 points.
Well, you know, the thing about that swinging gate, and that's just what a lot of people talk and call it different things, but you detach your people and make sure that we're going to go and not talk about that and talk about the touchdown here.
It's from the 14-yard line, just right up the middle. Good block from Chris Jones, and Abercrombie has all 8 for Coastal.
Okay, fans, here we go. As you can see, we put a picture on the video board of Bo here on campus. Every person who correctly tweets Bo's location at GS Bojangles will be entered into a drawing to win a $50 Bojangles gift card. We'll choose a $50 winner in a random drawing from all entries. The winner will be announced in the third quarter. And as a reminder, we'll be putting on a fireworks extravaganza a few minutes after today's game. Be sure to stick around for a great show.
Eight nothing, the Chanticleers leading the Runnin Bulldogs behind the hard running of Oshamar Abercrombie. Third year sophomore, pretty special back behind D'Angelo Henderson. Coach, what do you see here on the PAT?
Well, they've got basically 4-on-3 here. This is like basketball. They got more people than they've got, but a missed tackle here. Somebody forgot to block the guy, but he puts his head down and gets it in there. That's what it's all set up for, and we get the kickoff going here and see if they can make some kind of return.
Not much, shy of the 15-yard line. That was Chad Jeter, junior linebacker who missed the tackle. He's one of the league's leaders in tackles.
Well, good coaching there by the Gardner Webb Runnin Bulldogs. They were set up and everything was perfect. You just got to finish the tackle. We've seen 3 missed tackles already in this first quarter. Early in the game against Henderson, another one on the touchdown, and then that one on the 2-point play. And I'm sure Coach McCurry's talking to his team about, along with his brother, who's a defensive coordinator, we got to wrap up against these guys. They're not going to go down easy.
Victor Harris and Adonis Lee at the top of your screen. Maxwell keeps it himself and slithers forward for 8.
Tremendous advantage here to have a quarterback that can run with a football with a lead blocker. I mean, when you can make 8 yards on a power play with your quarterback running, you got a good chance of getting some offense going.
He's crossed over 100 yards rushing 3 different times this year, including against Liberty, when he ran for 173 yards, which was the most ever for a Runnin Bulldog quarterback in a single game. Drop back, and then Maxwell turns on the Jets. He flops over the 25-yard line.
Now move the chains.
Dante Hears with a stop.
Made by Dante Hears.
I like the poise by Maxwell there. They were going to take a deep shot. He wasn't there. He knew the down and distance, and he didn't take a loss. Picked up the first down with his athleticism.
Blackman just replaced Bernard in the backfield. Bernard coming off a big game last week against Presbyterian. The Runnin Bulldogs won 14-10 on the road. Maxwell keeps it again. And a solid 4.5, 5-yard gain.
Throughout the day, we'll see the tremendous stress that this young man puts on the defense. They've run the outside zone and handed it to their running back and also the wide receiver. That time, he decided to pull it because the linebackers were running out. Another big first down gain of 5 yards. And as long as you don't lose yardage and you're running this style of attack, you're going to make a lot of first downs.
Maxwell gives it this time, and Bernard goes nowhere.
You know, my grandson would say to me, say, hey, Big D. You know, when you say, hey, as long as you don't lose yardage, you'll make first downs. I meant that you just can't have lost yardage plays. But how about this really good stick?
Jabari Bothwell.
Really good job by Bothwell. Filling the hole and putting the pressure on Maxwell now. Third down, let's see if they move him out and put him on the perimeter with some type of sprint out.
Coastal is named Bothwell. It's defensive MVP 5 times in 8 games this year. His 6th tackle for a loss on the season. Maxwell fires high and incomplete, intended for the big tight end, Mike Estes. It'll be fourth down.
Intended to Victor Harris.
We've seen Hears make some pretty good plays throughout the day.
And,
you know, he played the sticks there, Evan. He knew it was 3rd and 7, and he really squatted on that route and was all over it, forced an errant throw there. And one bad play, and you're punting against this team.
Fourth and 6 from the 30. And Komornik with a high spiral. This is Chris Jones down the sideline. A short return.
Chris Jones on the punt return.
Coastal will begin its 3rd possession from right around the 33-yard line. Chanticleer's offensive unit has averaged about 440 yards per game. They've scored over 30 points a game. And Alex Ross is often at the center of it all. With a huge game today, he could become the Big South's all-time leader in total offense. Chasing former Charleston Southern QB Colin Drafts in that department. Gets a little closer on first down. Throwing across the middle to Matt. Great story, Coach, that Bruce Matt told me last year. When he came on his recruiting trip to Coastal Carolina, he thought all of the BAM signs were for him because his initials are B-A-M, Bruce Allen Mapp. He called his dad back in Philly and said, you wouldn't believe what they've done for me here.
Well, I mean, they probably told him they did it for one day, maybe. Who knows? You know, never know about these recruiting promises, but I like the style that this Coastal team has come out with today. They're using a lot of different formations, and they're using everybody in the offensive set. They're throwing to the tight ends, throwing to wide receivers, doing a really good job of running the underneath stuff, and they're really giving a steady dose of Henderson along with Abercrombie.
Henderson again. If Trey Lucas didn't trip him up, he would still be running.
Go by Tyler Lucas.
you get a good shot at this offensive line. Very big physical kids that really stay together on this zone scheme and get to the second level. As long as you can get that far down the field with the offensive lineman in front of you, you're going to make a lot of yards, and that's why Henderson's got over 3,000 in his career.
Saw the right guard, Sam Ekwenike, didn't even have anybody to block. He just ran forward alongside Hop Henderson. Ross down the middle. Tipped and caught off the deflection, a miraculous touchdown. The tight end, Craig White. That is not how the offensive coordinator, Dave Patnod, drew it up, I think.
Well, that looked like what you do on a Hail Mary as far as the tip drill. White was just kind of following the play. He was a secondary receiver. And we'll get a shot at the Coastal team again, giving a little bit different look here on their swinging gate. Now their guard's coming over there. They're going to probably call them in and kick it now. They've already gotten two today, and that's usually what you do after you don't make it, after you make it the first time, excuse me.
39 yards on the score. Alex Ross with his first touchdown pass in conference play. And Ryan Granger sends it through. 15-0 here in the opening quarter. First touchdown catch of the year for Craig White, and it wasn't even intended for him.
Yeah, you know, he was around the football, and the ball just goes up in the air, and he's Johnny on the spot. And I think it's the hair that was the difference. You know, just guys with long hair can get the tip drill.
Ball was deflected by Gardner Webb's linebacker, Tanner Birch. Got over 300 career tackles. And he thought he defended that play pretty good.
Yeah, I like Birch's depth there. And, you know, it's difficult for a linebacker to get that far down the field and play pass defense. He's used to playing the curl or playing the crossing routes. And I think he was kind of surprised that the ball was right there. And he did the what anybody would do, just stuck his one hand up instead of sticking both. And he probably could have had a chance for an interception. Here's a different look on the kickoff. They're going to spread out at the last second, so the blockers downfield can't identify where everybody's lined up. Pretty smooth move there.
Little hesitation and probably a wise decision to take a knee and take the free 25 yards.
Well, you talk about defining moments in the football game. You're on the road, you're playing against a team that's fighting to get in the FCS playoffs. They got you down 15-0. You've only made a couple first downs and you're starting out on your own 25 again. You're gonna have to generate something here to let your defense rest a little bit and get something on the board, because this game's gonna get out of hand if they don't get a good drive here. And I'm not trying to be clairvoyant here. I'm just telling you from a coach, you can just feel it up here. This Coastal team is on fire today. They got a really good plan defensively, and they're mixing it up on their offense, and their special teams are ready to go.
Maxwell keeps it on first down, runs into Jabari Bothwell.
Tyrell Maxwell on the quarterback keeper.
So far today, we've seen Jabari Boswell play the underneath stuff pretty well, and the passing game be strong in the runs. And they're running a kind of loaded option here where one of the backs is blocking the guy responsible for the quarterback. But Boswell said, no, sir, I'm going to step up and wrap you up. And these guys like to hit the quarterback. They don't. This guy doesn't slide much. He goes on and takes it on down the field.
Maxwell's run for a while, had nowhere to throw it. And gain maybe 4 yards. It'll be third and four coming up as we wind down here in the opening quarter.
This Coastal defense is really sitting on the routes, and I think maybe not now where you got to maybe pick up a first down, but I think they got to take a deep shot around these defensive backs. They're just playing the routes and just not worrying about a deep throw from Maxwell. Even if you don't hit it, it's going to make you you're underneath the stuff a lot better.
On third down, the ball is tipped at the line of scrimmage. Coach, we'll see if you're clairvoyant, but it certainly seems like the Bulldogs are in some trouble.
Yeah, I mean, what we're seeing throughout college and pro football now is a lot of tip passes, and the reason for that is that if a lineman gets engaged there and he really can't get down the field, he just stops right at that point of the tackle. I like J.J. Watt, sticks his hand up. It used to be everybody would try to come on in even if you were engaged, but now they're saying if you don't get initially around the blocker, just stay right there and get your hands up, and maybe you'll knock some down. And so far today, we've seen two against Maxwell.
Kick it down the middle this time, and a fair catch called for. Jesse June catches the punt with perhaps time for a play or two before we break at the end of one. D'Angelo Henderson on the verge of 1,000 yards for the second straight season. He had over 1,500 last year. He's three away from 1,000 in his junior season. And right now, Henderson out there with Abercrombie alongside Ross. Ross rambles right and takes it out of bounds.
You like your quarterback to be smart there. They had it set up to throw an out and up, and the outside receiver decided he couldn't get around the guy, so he just broke it off there. But usually after you've scored twice like they have at the end of the quarter, you take a shot. They had it called. They came back, and Ross showed you the potential that he has as an all-star quarterback, because he made a good decision there as we finished the first half.
Well, they'll switch sides of the field. Coastal Carolina has it at its own 35-yard line. A dominant first quarter for the Chanticleers. Joe Moglia's team in front 15-0 as we begin the second quarter here in Conway. And that guy's had such an interesting life. His father was born in Italy, came to the country when he was 11, never finished eighth grade, worked at a fruit shop in New York City his entire life. His mom was born in Ireland, never finished high school. Not only did he finish high school, but he went to college, became a college football coach. Spent a lot of time in the business world, incredible success, and now on the verge of a record-breaking tenure at Coastal Carolina. Alex Ross on the opening play of the second quarter runs for a couple, and it'll be third down. Coach, what stood out to you about the Coastal Carolina offense in that opening quarter?
Just the diversity, the ability to take what the defense gives them. You got an outstanding quarterback that can call the game at the line, and they hurt you with a lot of different elements, underneath to the tight end, outside routes to map, and both the running backs did a good job.
Ross fumbled the snap. The ball was tipped, and it's picked off. This is DJ Allen, who replaced Ivan Toomer for the Runnin Bulldogs. And that might be exactly what the Runnin Bulldogs needed. The flag was down.
The play just didn't start out the right way. We get the penalty here.
Jeff Flanagan, the referee today.
The return, block in the back. Return team, number 95. 10-yard penalty, first down.
You know, you see so many blocks in the back, and most of them occur in punting situation and also when change of possession, because the team that's the defensive players aren't used to blocking, and so they aren't near as adept at, we'll see this right here. Really good job on the tip drill, and we didn't get to see the snap there, but Ross missed the snap, and then here he comes, and here he comes back, and looked like he had a shot at catching it, and good job on the tip drill. It's always in play. We've seen two straight tips, one for a touchdown, one for an interception.
That's karma for what happened on the Craig White touchdown. Adams tipped it, and Allen intercepted. So this is Gardner Webb's best field position of the day by far. Out to the 49-yard line on first down.
A good recognition by offensive coordinator Brett Nichols. I mean, you just can't handle the ball every play like Maxwell's doing. You know, there was about five successive plays where he either ran or passed the ball, and as good as he is, you can be successful, but you can also make mistakes. So take a little pressure off him. Very comforting to a quarterback to just turn and hand the ball to a back once in a while when you're trying to read everything.
Estes in motion. There was movement up front.
The one thing you tell your lineman here, I'm going to do my coaching.
Offense, number 60, 5-yard penalty, second down.
When a guy's going in motion, what's the defensive guy going to say? Motion! Well, he's going to say that. That doesn't mean you got to jump. So be ready for a different style voice coming there and just relax. I mean, they're going to tell you the guy's in motion. And invariably, the linemen jump. How'd you like that voice inflection?
That's got to be frustrating for the coach, too, when they...
I'm sure coach has gone over it 1,000 times.
Maxwell throws short and again off target, looking for Estes. Now, going back to what you said about getting other players involved, like Carroll McRae, understandably, is a little worried about the beatdown that Maxwell's going to take if he tries to do everything himself.
Yeah, I agree with it. We talked to him earlier in the week, and he said he's gotten better at jumping out of bounds and things like that. But he's just a running quarterback, and I had several play for me over the years, and they just got to get in the hot tub all week and get ready to go and be ready on Saturdays.
Third down. Pressure coming. And Maxwell's hit. Rod Holder, among other Chanticleer linemen, brought him down in the backfield.
Well, one of the first times today we saw some pressure by the Chanticleer defense, bringing some edge pressure, and that opened up the vertical look, and we got a good shot here of just too many guys to block there, and Maxwell in that kind of situation, just go down and don't get a turnover.
Holder and Hollenhorst probably will get half a sack each there. Gardner Webb cannot capitalize on the turnover. This is Jones from the 18. Taken down from behind by Kenyatta Dunbar.
You know, earlier in this quarter, you were talking about Coach Mowgli and about, you know, his rise as a coach and what he's been able to do. I really like the plan that they have in place here at Coastal to go to the Sun Belt Conference. Next year, they'll be ineligible for the championship, but they've got a good plan in place. Georgia Southern and Appalachian have proven that there's plenty of players around the contiguous states of South Carolina, North Carolina, and Georgia to have a really good program. And you talked about in the opening, having 33-3 against FCS teams. I mean, they're ready to make this jump. An outstanding potential in this area too. The fans are behind the program, and you know, certainly you got Clemson and South Carolina, but I think you can see the kind of enthusiasm he brings to this program.
Tyler Keene is the injured shot to clear. 12:34 to go in the second quarter. Coach, you have firsthand experience of a team going from the FCS to the FBS level. At the time, it was 1AA to 1A. He told me this week that you had very little control of what Marshall did in the mid-90s.
Well, you know, when I went there, the idea was we were going to build a stadium and we were going to go to 1A, and we had a terrible stadium over there at Fairfield, and we're going to take a break. And I hope everybody comes back to listen to this big story about how Marshall went from 1AA to 1A.
See the backup linebacker Kyle Fleetwood getting carted off the field, junior from Stone Mountain, Georgia. We hope he is all right. Here's what happened on the punt return. Right there in the middle of the shot, Fleetwood tumbling over, grabbed his leg immediately.
I always hate for any player to go down, particularly when he's really not even involved. He was just hustling and the guy just rolled him up from behind.
Here's D'Angelo Henderson to the outside. And a little extracurricular activity after the play. On that carry, it didn't seem too spectacular, but he just crossed over 1,000 yards for the season.
This guy's got some, Coach Switzer used to say.
Horse caller. Defense, number 48, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Quick as a hiccup. I mean, this guy can really jump around and go from his regular speed to overdrive in his first or second steps, and getting a good idea about how he can accelerate to the outside. That's about the second time he's just gotten the edge with his tremendous quickness.
Quick hitch to Wyke.
And when you play three deep coverage and you don't jam the outside receivers, it opens up the flat because the outside guy's going to, this is a really good shot. See how deep these defensive backs are playing right here?
You're giving him 15 yards.
It just opens up the underneath guy in the slot. He's going to come and run underneath where this guy cleared. Same play, but to the outside receiver. I mean, if it's working, you might as well stay with it.
And that's Jones, who's once again out there in the spot of John Israel.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, number 6, 15-yard penalty, down.
Okay, Coach, your team just delivered back-to-back penalties.
30 yards, 3 first downs, and you're being beat 15-0. Your last series out there, you got a turnover, and now all of a sudden, you're just giving them yardage, and this team's way too good to give them 30 yards. We used to call that smash and crash. You know, if the outside guy would go and hook up, the other guy would go deep, and then exactly opposite. It's pretty easy.
Henderson back to the left. D'Angelo Henderson to the end zone.
He's got the spin move working on his laundromat right now. This young man has shown you a lot of different variables in the way he can attack the perimeter of the defense. And you had it down. You said he had his own spin move, and we've seen him spin to the right, spin to the left, stand up, fight, fight, fight. He can do it all.
Yes, he can. That's a 27-yard touchdown rush for Hop Henderson. He's now scored a touchdown, Coach, in 23 consecutive football games.
Well, give us how they call him Hop instead of Spin. That's a pretty good nickname, but yeah. I'd have to call him Spin today. I mean, wow.
He got that nickname Hop all the way back in high school when he was banged up with an ankle injury, returned faster than everybody thought, and was hopping around the field. It's hard to break down then. Probably learned the spin move back then, too.
Well, he's starting to run one way and then redirects, sets up the block. He gets hit. That really wasn't a spin move there as much as just running out of the tackle. And boy, I tell you what, when you can make that kind of run in open field, it opens up everything. It's a really good end zone shot. You know, you're not just going to wrap this guy up high. You got to get down and break down on him. He's not going down very easily. We've seen broken tackles. Talked about it from the first quarter on. This running Bulldog team is very good fundamentally, but there are way too many mistakes on that drive. You mentioned 2 15-yard penalties, very soft coverage on the outside where they hit 2 underneath routes. And then when you got a guy like this Henderson kid, and we saw Abercrombie break tackles too. I mean, 1-2 punch for this offense. And Gardner Webb, to me, is a solid football team. But if you're a good football team, you're not going to miss as many tackles as they have today. And I'm sure Coach McCrary and the defensive staff are going to be all over them at halftime about fundamentals.
Between the missed tackles and the penalties, the offense has only converted 2 first downs. It has not been pretty so far for the crew from Boiling Springs. But how about this? A little burst upfield on the return. Jonathan Blackman out across the 40. They'll spot it right at the 40-yard line. So the Runnin Bulldogs will have good field position for the second straight possession.
You know, Evan, they haven't gotten over 20 yards in a possession today. They got 27 and got a penalty, but they've got to sustain themselves. Get 3 or 4 first downs, find a way to make a big play, take a deep shot. But right now, their offense has got to make something happen.
Maxwell didn't see any daylight up the middle. So to the outside, he gains a few. Coach, you were telling us about Marshall's transition from 1AA to 1A, and it's a similar transition that Coastal Carolina is about to embark on.
Yeah, we were thinking about it, talked about it in the spring, and I went up for a fundraiser up in Dayton, Ohio, and we didn't have cell phones back then, but I called in the office and I said, what's going on? And the secretary said, you need to call the president. And I thought something was bad, and I called him. He said, what do you think about going 1A? I said, well, I don't know. I'm not sure about it. And he said, what do you think about it? And I said, well, I guess so. And he said, okay, we're going to announce it at 2:30 today. So
you didn't have much say over it is what you're saying.
No, I didn't. But they did. They made the right move, and Marshall did a good job very quickly getting in the MAC and winning bowl games.
Offside defense, number 4, 5-yard penalty, second down.
C.J. Thompson with a big hit, but he's also penalized 5 yards.
Well, here's a really good time for Maxwell today to look at this shot right here. A good shot for down the field. You got a waist down here. You got second and 2. You've been having trouble making first downs. Go ahead and let one fly here.
The handoff doesn't lead to much. Elijah Perry getting some carries today. Josh Bautista did not make the trip, banged up this week. The running back core has just been very thin for Carroll McRae's team all season long. Kerry Bernard thought they would be the number one guy all through the spring, looked good. Second to last day of spring ball, hurts his ankle. Really struggles to get back. The space closed quick on Maxwell. C.J. Thompson, Samson Baldwin right there.
You like the way this Coastal defense is flying around. Coach Moglia talked about all week he's going to make some changes or make these guys earn their spots again, and it's pretty obvious he got their attention. Hey, if you're going to play for this football team, you can't flip-flop around. You got to play every down like it's your last one, and they're playing with a lot of intensity and really good fundamental football team at this point so far through a quarter and a half.
Too many breakdowns last week for Coach Moglia's liking. There's the shot down the middle you were looking for. Excellent coverage from C.J. Thompson on Trey Bryce.
You like the positioning of C.J. Thompson. Just right where he's supposed to be, uses his off arm to knock the ball down. This is tremendous technique here, right into the sun, but just really outstanding. Usually a guy will grab a guy's jersey or something like that and hope to rest. That's just perfect position and a really good throw by Maxwell. I mean, if he doesn't make that play, that's a touchdown.
Third and 7 from the Coastal 44. They hand it off to Blackman. He's shy of the sticks.
You know, we talk about tackling, and that's the difference in these two teams right now. When a guy from Coastal's got a chance to make a play in the open field, we're seeing some outstanding tackling. And that's what you got to have if you're going to be a championship team. And I think certainly Coach Moglia got it across to his team. We're going to do better. And they had a hard time. You had the game last week. Charleston Southern really moved the ball up and down the field on.
Fourth and 4 from the Coastal 41. Gardner Webb lines up to punt. And the punt will pin Coastal back inside its own 20. It'll be spotted at the 12. Timeout on the field with the Chanticleers in front 22-0. Coastal Carolina in front 22 to nothing over Gardner Webb. You know, there are over a billion people in the world on Facebook. But those girls are looking at Facebook right now. Someone should go tell them to like the ASN Facebook page. All sorts of news and notes, videos and highlights. Check it out live on ASN. First play out of the break, and Alex Ross sends one deep and over the head of his target, but a flag came in late. Mark Eyrick, the intended receiver, hasn't played a whole lot this year, but they expected him to
pass
get some time today.
Defense, number 36, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Yeah, Mike Kaywood, SID, was telling us that this kid was going to get in and get a shot and showed some speed there. I mean, really got down the field with a lot of velocity. And we also saw the kind of arm strength that Alex Ross has, and look for him to take a couple more shots if he can set him up like that.
And another costly penalty for the Runnin Bulldogs, basically giving up their decent field position on the punt.
Yeah, I mean, in this quarter alone, they've had three major penalties, 45 yards, and, you know, that's just not the style of this team. Usually pretty well disciplined, but you get infuriated a little bit and get ticked off because the team's moving. You try to take things in your own hands sometimes, and it hurts your team.
Ross hits Mapp, and a good tackle by DJ Allen. Allen's done a decent job off the bench in the place of Ivan Toomer, who went out with the injury.
Yeah, we saw Toomer go down, and as the game has progressed, we've seen DJ Allen get a little more comfortable. He's from a good program there in Riverdale, Georgia. That, you know, a lot of good athletes come out of that area. Hines Ward, a guy that played for me, he's from Riverdale.
Sure. Pretty good player.
I guarantee you one thing, Hines Ward didn't mind playing any position. He wouldn't mind playing defensive back, being the water boy, whatever it took, and just to have an outstanding career for the Steelers.
There's Oshamar Abercrombie. We saw glimpses from him last year. 300 yards, four touchdowns. Closing in on 400 yards. He's already got five touchdowns this year. This time runs into the arms of Tanner Birch. Birch missed all of last year, back this year. He's the team's leading tackler in 12 and 13. Fifth-year senior from Savannah.
Gained up 1 yard, second down and nine.
With a pretty good beard. The beard of a grizzled veteran. Ross waited patiently to hit Wyke. And another missed tackle, right as we're talking about him. Tanner Birch completely lost Wyke when he had him wrapped up.
You know, White throughout the game has made the underneath catches, also the tip ball for a touchdown. But this young man as a tight end is so prevalent in this attack because the underneath coverage has to worry about stopping the run, and that just opens up those little dump passes to the tight end.
Ross to throw again, steps up, goes down. Chad Cheater with a sack.
You know, we talked about our Coke performer, O.J. Mao, and you put so much pressure on your inside people to try to double team him that opens up the outside people. And you see this just a no hitter by the back here. You've got to do a better job, Henderson, if you're going to be a pass protector. He's a great runner, but you can't just duck your head.
A lesson he'll certainly learn in the film room this week. Ross again shows the arm right on the money to the near sideline for Mapp.
Three deep coverage is just inviting the underneath throws, and they're being very patient, bend and don't break defense, but Ross is going to take what you give him. You saw him hit the tight ends. You've seen him throw the outside receivers on the short things, and they got to get enough running game to keep the pass rush from getting after you.
This is the other tight end, A.J. Sattinger. And that's another first down. Wow. Coastal Carolina with 16 first downs already in this game. The Gardner Webb defense only surrendered 9 first downs the entirety of last week in a win against Presbyterian. Ball spotted at the 14. And it's Henderson again to the end zone. His second of the half. Coastal Carolina rolling at home today.
Alex Ross needs to have a bad ankle every week because he's done everything you need today, throwing the ball, orchestrating the offense at the line of scrimmage. That time he held the ball to the right time and pitched it to the perimeter. And when your run support has to worry about defending the pass, it's hard to play the option. And they're playing three deep on them, and they're just not up there quick enough to stifle those pitches on the option.
Ranger tacks on the extra point. D'Angelo Henderson's over 100 yards in a game for the 6th time this year. The 3 games we didn't have 100, he had at least 91. He's very consistent. The kid from Somerville to the end zone. Coastal Carolina offense has broken a bunch of records these past few years. Lorenzo Taliaferro set the stage, and then D'Angelo Henderson replaced him. Number 31 in black with his 38th career touchdown.
Well, just outstanding blocking on the perimeter, and when you can seal the edge inside with your big guys, you take it, watch the way these guys seal it, then the end man on the line's got the quarterback and the downfield blocking's right there. And what you always tell your running backs, let's remember this, we'll come back to it after this kickoff return. A lot of good shots of that, but we say if you just look at the field, you've got the hash mark, the numbers, and the pylon on the out of bounds. We say run the ladder. Pretend there's a ladder between the hash mark and the end zone there, and you run right down that ladder at that angle, and it's hard for people to attack you if you do a good job blocking. Guys have a tendency to try to cut back against the grain, and then here comes everybody on the pursuit. He ran the ladder exactly right there. Tremendous run and good blocking and well-conceived play.
And that's just about vision and finding the right angle?
Exactly, but you know where that ladder, just pretend that ladder's laying out there, hash mark the numbers to the outside. We're not talking about a fire truck either. We're talking about a ladder. Let's see if he runs a ladder here.
Long way to go for Gardner Webb. And another big hit.
You know, one of the things these coaches do when they talk to us on these meetings that our producer, Gary McCullough, sets up with us is talk to you about the theme of the week. And what Coach Mowgli had talked about was he wanted to make sure his team was fundamentally right because he felt like they gave away too many plays last week. Certainly the caliber of competition might not be quite as good as it was last week, but they're really doing a good job in the open field.
There's Devin Brandt, the transfer from Western Michigan, with a big hit. Maxwell pitches it to Blackman. And he's across the 25. That's enough for a first down.
I like the way Maxwell now is dishing it off a little bit. He's been a little bit too quick to keep the ball, Evan. That time, he kind of got what we say, get in the defensive end's lips. You know, step on his toes and then pitch the ball. And he did a really good job of letting it go. The one thing that's going to hurt Coastal a little bit is these transfers now. Once they get into to the FBS, these guys can't play immediately. They'll have to sit out a year.
That's right.
That's going to be a different situation for them.
It's a big adjustment. Maxwell's throw is rejected. Marcus Williamson, we saw him block a kick last week.
Like that Marcus's gloves, too. I mean, those gloves got that boom, boom, pow. As we continue to watch these people throughout college and pro football knock plays down, and the reason is they can't get penetration, so they just stop at the line and get their hands up. And Tyrell Maxwell's got to understand that. Here's running. That's the way to run the option right there.
Good fake from Maxwell. And that's his best run of the game.
We got a really good shot in the opening before the game started of the athletic body that this young man has. He's kind of a lot more physical than I thought he was going to be the way he runs with toughness, but his quickness is outstanding. That time he faked the pitch and turned it up inside. Big first down.
First time today that Gardner Webb has put together multiple first downs on a drive.
I think Short Coach game. McCray told his offensive guys, hey, let's get out of this half. Let's take good care of the football. Let's see if we can get some back-to-back first downs and get it in there. And he's got a good coaching background. Coach McCray has been outstanding over the years. He knows what he's doing.
A couple years ago, Gardner Webb knocked off three top 25 teams in the season. Richmond, Wofford, and Charleston Southern. And there's a nice look from Maxwell downfield to Jacob Henderson and into Chanticleer territory.
Well, he had his eyes on the swivel there. It looked like the defense was going to hit him from behind. And really good job by Henderson cradling the ball and picking up the first down. Well, this would be just what the doctor ordered. They get some points here on the 2-minute drive.
They get the ball to start the second half, too. Gardner Webb has two timeouts left. Maxwell thrown as he got leveled by Williamson. Incomplete.
This is just not the running Bulldogs' style to throw drop back passes. And you see that with their offensive line getting beaten at the point of attack. They're more of a play action, scramble type blocking team, zone block. And you get in this situation, you get exposed a little bit. Might be ready for a quarterback draw here, the way the Coastal team's coming off the edge.
Right now, Maxwell is just 2 for 8. Jordan Jones lost his footing as he made the outcut. And I think I saw the referee make the signal that the throw was uncatchable there.
I don't know what he was saying. Looked to me like the defender hit him right as he made his break, but that's why we're up here and these officials are down there.
Gardner Webb has not converted a third down yet in the half. You know, Clayton Carlin, the defensive coordinator for Coastal, has to be very pleased with that performance. Deep ball down the middle, and it was a good-looking toss, but Jordan Jones tripped again.
Jordan's had two shots here of making a play and tripped both times. And pretty athletic kid. You don't expect him to do that. And I think the thing about Maxwell, and we talked about Evan, got so many different things happening to him. People tackling him, hitting him from behind. He needs some help from his other guys. I mean, you guy can't fall down when you got a chance to catch a pass.
And a punt sails into the end zone. A flag's down. It was a 4th and 10, so a 5-yard penalty would not be a first down for the Runnin Bulldogs. Kind of a frantic setup there with Coastal getting the punt defense onto the field.
I think Coach McCray is going to go for this if he gets his 5 yards. I mean, you're down.
Why not?
29-0. 4th and 5, you got a shot at it.
And it wasn't a great kick either, all the way into the end zone.
Yeah, you're talking about 22 yards difference.
Defense, 5-yard penalty, 4th down.
Gardner Webb has the punting team out there again. Well, night and day from last week in terms of the Coastal Carolina defensive effort. And I think the Chanticleers are going to take a timeout here to get their personnel
timeout
situated.
Coastal Carolina, their first.
Last week, Charleston Southern was 8 for 8 on third downs in the first half against the Shants defense. Today, Gardner Webb is 0 for 6.
Well, that's pretty good turnaround, 14 different areas there. I mean, any way you look at it, I can't even figure that out. But Coach McCray's looking at the morale of his team right now, you know, and I've been in this situation. You know, you got to figure out a way to get just a little juice for your team, because right now you're playing a team that's one of the best in the country on their home field. It's got a burr in their saddle. They got beat for the first time in a long time by an FCS team, and they've come back with a vengeance today, and he's getting the wrath of it. His team is. It's just an outstanding performance. I can't say anything, find too much wrong with this Coastal offense or defense and special team. And the only reason they called timeout there is they thought they were going to go for it, and then they put their punt return team in. Then after the penalty, thought they were going to go for it again. And so now they're going to punt it.
Kick bounces around the 7, and it's fumbled into the end zone. A microcosm of Gardner Webb's first half right there.
Yeah, you got a chance to back them up. You got two timeouts left, and you would force them to make one first down. But the one thing you want to tell your guy in that kind of situation is put your rear end to the end zone and turn around and try to look at the ball head up. You can't be on the side. It's hard to judge a ball sideways like that. And he didn't turn around enough to make the catch. Let's look and see what Coach Moglia does here. They got to see if they're going to try to hit the 2-minute offense or not. He got one of the best quarterbacks in the country orchestrating it.
Alex Ross, 10 of 12. And he runs it for the 7th time. Gains a couple.
I guarantee you one thing. If I'm Alex Ross at halftime, I say, Coach, I don't mind playing, but I don't need to be running with this ankle. And I'm sure they'll tell you that. That's the way the reads are, though. I mean, that was an outside zone, and everybody spread to the outside. But they're going to let the clock run down here and maybe just fall on it.
Would you be surprised if we saw the backup quarterback, Michael Church, in the second half, maybe give Alex Ross a little bit of a break?
Yeah, I think we'll probably see him, and probably pretty early.
To the 25-yard line goes Abercrombie. And unless there's a timeout, that'll be the final play of the opening half. Coach, you talked about how Coastal Carolina had to bounce back.
5-0.
A+.
Yeah, I give them at least an A. A+ is hard to come by. I mean,
there was the turnover.
Hey, they did have the turnover, which the tip pass, but Very effective offensive game plan, and defensively they tackled so much better. I was impressed with Max. We just got to see somebody else step up and help him. Receivers, running backs, offensive line, give the kids some help.
In terms of total yards, Coastal 280, Gardner Webb 89. Runnin Bulldogs have a lot of work to do. Some soul searching as they head to the locker room. Coastal Carolina, a top 10 team in the country, has used a little luck as well. Two touchdowns for D'Angelo Henderson in the opening 30 minutes. The Chanticleers with a huge halftime lead at home.
We have like 6 minutes, all right?
We'll see.
Beach. So. Okay. How long have you been to the Myrtle Beach Chamber?
Joined in 98, so it's not too much. Where are you from originally?
I'm from Boston. Can you give him a mic check?
Yeah, checking. 1, 2, 3. Check 1, 2, 3. I didn't pick up the Boston accent. You lost it?
No, I'm very fortunate to not have the Boston accent. I couldn't do TV down south if I had a thick Boston accent, but big Boston sports fan.
Oh, for Red Sox all the way then, right?
Oh, they were saying just a little bit higher was perfect.
A little bit higher.
Okay.
Very good. But,
I didn't want the natural with that.
Face made for radio, unfortunately.
So what were you going to say about what you want to talk about? Where
you know, I think a lot of people think of Myrtle Beach as summer vacation, but really the fall is the best time. So much to going on here, and the weather's great, days like today. Coastal, big impact on the community, economically and otherwise. And, you know, we're excited about the future for Coastal and sports tourism.
How you doing?
Great reason to blare the horns at halftime here in Conway. A dominant first 30 minutes for the Chanticleers. They lead it 29-0, four touchdowns with a two-point conversion mixed in as well. Hi again, everybody. Evan Lepler with a special guest, Brad Dean from the Myrtle Beach Area Chamber of Commerce. In fact, he's the president. Brad, welcome, and what a beautiful day. It's November, and it feels like springtime.
Hey, welcome to Myrtle Beach, and this is exactly what we like it to be in the fall. It's like 60 more days of summer.
It's unbelievable because you come to Myrtle Beach in November or February, and it's not like the rest of the Mid-Atlantic region in any way.
Well, you know, and most people know us as a great summer beach destination, a place you bring your family for an affordable family vacation. But the fall was actually the greatest time to visit. The weather's still warm, the water is gorgeous, and all of the attractions and restaurants are really a lot slower. The hotel rates are affordable. It's a great place for a family getaway in the fall.
And here's a look at some of the nice beachfront area. There's plenty of that sand for everybody to go around.
You know, 60 miles of beautiful, soft, sandy beaches. So if you can't find a spot on the beach in Myrtle Beach this time of year, then you're just not looking hard enough.
And you were just telling me the impact Coastal Carolina's athletics department has had on the Myrtle Beach area as a whole.
Yeah, Coastal Carolina University is really redefining the Grand Strand. Economically, it has a huge impact, not only by creating lots of jobs, but they're also turning out some very talented students. And their athletic department is on fire, not only with the wins and losses on the field, but they are such a community-centered organization outside of the campus that they're having a great impact throughout the entire Grand Strand.
What were your thoughts on the first half today from the Chanticleers?
Well, you know, after last week's disappointing loss, we knew the Chants would come out ready to play, and it looks like Gardner Webb may be a little overmatched, but you can never count them out in the second half, and Chanticleers have to show up in the second half, and frankly, have to show up every game this year if we're going to get a good spot in the playoffs.
Yeah, and that's certainly something that everybody's talking about. We're chatting with Brad Dean, the president of the Myrtle Beach Area Chamber of Commerce. And, you know, Joe Mowgli has got a pretty nice gig here. He's got a lot of wins under his belt, a lot of talent, and a lot of great golf courses to play.
That's right. Of course, Coach Mowgli doesn't have much time to play golf. He's spending more time on the field. But, you know, in Myrtle Beach, you could golf every day for 3 months and still not golf the same course twice.
That's unbelievable. Do you have a favorite course personally?
You know, of course, at the Chamber of Commerce, all of our children are beautiful.
Right,
but,
sure.
We've got some extraordinary courses on the north end that will challenge the best of golfers. But then a lot of times, new golfers, novice golfers, or families who just want to take mom and dad and the kids out like to prefer some of the shorter ranges on the south end. Whether you're looking for a PGA type experience or just want an affordable golf vacation, there's something for you in the Myrtle Beach area.
I'm sure you can reach out to Brad Dean and he'll give you all the advice about the sand traps and the fairways and which holes to avoid here in the Grand Strand as well. Brad Dean, thanks so much for joining us and best of luck. You have this teal turf now. You like this too?
Oh, I do. I love it. It really stands out, and of course it gives us a great way to stand out on television on the American Sports Network.
Things are going well here in Myrtle Beach. 29-0, and look at that. Doesn't get any better than this for the Chanticleers. A lead and a view to remember.
Thank you. Thank you.
All sorts of halftime festivities here at Brooks Stadium in Conway, South Carolina. Their hometown Chanticleers are up big at the break. Welcome back, everybody. Evan Lepler with the legendary Hall of Fame coach Jim Donnan. This guy won a lot of games as a college football coach, but it happens to everybody. Occasionally, you take one on the chin. When you're down by four touchdowns at the half, what can you say to your team?
Well, the first thing you do is go in and assess what you think, talk to your coaches about your game plan and what you need to change. A little bit of the fact that just fundamentally, Gardner Webb has missed a lot of tackles, and we saw one drive where they gave 45 yards in penalties. So you cut the penalties down, find somebody to catch the football. They've been terrible throwing the ball. And, you know, overall, let's just play this half. We got a lot of pride. We're a better team than this. Let's see what we can make of. But, we're going against a team that's playing at an optimum level, though. I tell you, I came down here with the idea of seeing a pretty good team. I saw a great football team in this first half. Coach Mowgli has really got them rolling today.
Coach Mowgli has his team up by 29 points. Elsewhere around the Big South, Charleston Southern has officially clinched a share of the Big South regular season title. The Buccaneers are headed to the FCS playoffs, a 28-14 victory over Kennesaw State. Liberty and Presbyterian halfway home as well. And here's a look at the updated standings. What a season for Jamie Chadwell's Bucks.
Yeah, they really have played outstanding. As you mentioned, they got a big game coming up here against a tremendous rival here. They're trying to pick up somebody in FBS. Who are they playing?
Charleston Southern has to play Alabama.
Oh, yeah, Alabama. That's their new rival. Yeah, let's go. But I wasn't sure if you were telling me the truth there. They're really going to go get them then.
A couple of weeks from now, the Buccaneers will face Alabama, but they'll go to Tuscaloosa knowing that they're the Big South champs.
Watch out, Nick. Watch out. They're coming.
Coastal Carolina will kick off to begin the second half when we come back.
Sun setting here in Conway, South Carolina. Ashanta clears with a very impressive performance, showing that they're very deserving of still being in the top 10. This is the 25th consecutive week that Coastal Carolina football has been in the top 10. It's what Joe Moglia had in mind when he came to Conway.
Pretty impressive, that's no question. And they got an outstanding team. If they just keep playing like this, they got to go a long way. They're going to go a long way in the playoffs.
And a big stick. Number 28, Isaac Martin, punishing the kick returner for Gardner Webb.
You know, we talked about, I don't want to forget to mention the fact they're going, you know, moving to the next level. And with that, it's going to be some stadium expansion. They're going to try to get this stadium up to 15 or 16,000 pretty quickly. As soon as the season's over, they're going to start some new construction. And I think certainly this is a beautiful field and all that, but you know, getting that extra space will really help their attractions, bringing some good teams in to play them.
No question about that. Kerry Bernard goes nowhere, loses a couple. Defensive play made by Alex Scarce. Moved from safety to linebacker last year. Junior with a tackle for the loss. It's second and 12.
You like the way that Coach Carlin has coached this defense to slow play Tyrell Maxwell. And by that, I mean they're not letting him make an easy decision. They're always just kind of hovering there and make him keep the ball the last second, and then the pursuit takes over.
Maxwell keeps it, takes it near the 15. Bernard did get that shoulder pad tucked underneath the jersey right before that ball was snapped. He was having some trouble with it.
There's a really good shot there of the athletic body that Maxwell has. He's like a running back there, quarterback, and he's taking some shots today, but to get anything going offensively, they're going to have to hit some passes. Only 2 out of 8 in the first half, and both those were short completions. So receivers got to stand up too. He's had some guys open and they've fallen down.
Only 20 yards passing for Tyrell Maxwell. On third down, decent job protecting, and they complete it for the first down. Jacob Henderson.
Well, Jacob Henderson's got to be my go-to guy. That's his second reception of the game, and both of them have been difficult. But he did a really good job of changing his body position and turning it. And Tyrell Maxwell showed you a lot of points there. He got a lot of pressure up front and then broke to the outside. Very good end zone shot. I'd watch him shoot to the outside and then throw the ball across his body, which you shouldn't do normally. But when you're desperate, you try that. And what a good run after the catch. Now we got a little juice going here for the Runnin Bulldogs.
That was a 33-yard gain for Henderson. Best of his season. And another big hit, and Ashana Clear shaken up. Michael Billings appears to be in some pain.
Tackle made by Michael Billings.
We always tell your offensive players it takes two to make a lick. Just because the defensive guys are hitting you doesn't mean that you can't hit back. And on that play, a really good job of attacking with your pads as a running back. I like the way that they both of these teams, their offensive backs really do a good job of meeting the licks and trying to push the pile or push the guy in the open field.
They check on Billings down on the field. We remind you, you can follow your high school team live with ASN and ScoreStream. Just download the free ScoreStream app to get real-time scores, photos, video, chat, and more. Follow prep sports like never before with ScoreStream.
That's a good app, even for an old coach like me, because let me tell you something. When you've lived as many places and coached as many, I got friends around the country, and their kids are playing high school football, and they're in the playoffs now, and you really want to keep up with what's going on. And there's nothing like playing on a championship team, whether it means you're regional champion or you're district champion. But a high school kid might be the last time they ever play, and boy, I tell you, high school football right now is at a premium as you try to get in these playoffs. And the ScoreStream is a really good app to find out what's going on. How about that promo?
Coach Donnan, when did you get your first smartphone?
What are you talking about, man? I've been pretty much up on things for a long time.
When you were coaching, did you have a smartphone?
No, I didn't even have a phone.
That's right.
Hey, one of the first things I did when I got to Georgia was tell Coach Dooley, look, said Alexander Graham Bell had this phone here in my office. I need to get a new one. And Tubby Smith said the same thing. We only had one phone in our office at the University of Georgia when I got there. Finally, we got three lines.
At least it wasn't a pay phone.
Well, you know, they had to call in and collect.
Probably not the best way to call a recruit.
Yeah. But Twitter would have driven me crazy, I can tell you that.
Maxwell keeps it and goes down. He had nowhere he could have gone. Aaron McFarland was there first.
When you play against an option team defensively, Evan, that's a little philosophy. Make that quarterback execute. Really good job by the defenders keeping their shoulders square. Make him execute because he's going to have a chance to execute 70 times in a game. Even if he has a good game and does 60 right, he's going to have 10 bad plays. Lost yardage plays are killing the Runnin Bulldogs. Now they're in the second and 17.
Yeah, lost about seven on the first down play. Maxwell lofts one deep. Estes makes the catch. That was a pretty rainbow throw.
Well, I like that, and you know, we can't pull for either team, but I'm pulling for Maxwell just to get some help out there. And we've seen Henderson make a good catch, and now SD's running with the under control and corralling that ball in open field. Now they're in a position in the four down zone. Watch him step up into this throw and put some air under it. Outstanding throw, and one of the good things about Estes, he waited the last second to extend his arms.
Another negative play on first down.
I just don't like these east and west plays. When you're inside the 20, go right at them, because all you can, it might break. It could break, you know, but when you do not execute, then you end up with a lost yardage. That's two straight first down plays that they've had lost yardage, and they're in the red zone now, and they got three downs to make it, but go right at them.
First trip to the red zone for the Runnin Bulldogs today. Maxwell, incomplete. Again, he was forced to throw that one quickly.
Got to learn how to step up in the pocket a little bit or to avoid the rush. You're seeing some delayed blitzes here by the Coastal team, doing a really good job of disguising their coverage, bringing their linebackers late and getting in his grill and making him throw some passes he doesn't like to. I still think Coach McCray feels like this is a four down situation. I don't think they'll go for the field goal here.
Got to gain something on third and 15.
Well, he's got to now. He's going to have to go for the field goal. But, you know, any way you look at it, you know, the first drive of the second half, we talked about at halftime. What do you tell your team? Hey, let's build on something. They built with a good drive. That's a over 60 yards there, yep, that they hadn't gotten more than two first downs, a really good march. A little bit different field goal situation here. They've got an unbalanced line with two wings here instead of a wing on each side.
Fourth and 12 and a flag thrown.
Might be too many people on the field here.
Defense, 12 and 4 minutes. 5 yard penalty, fourth down.
He didn't want to tell you everything that I did, but they had too many on the field, that's for sure. Sometimes those referees don't want to they're doing that discount double check out there, and they don't want you to hear everything.
Not the first time today that Coastal Carolina has messed up its personnel in a special team situation.
You know, I'm going to take up for them, though, because you're ahead 29-0. You probably figured they're going to go for it. But, you know, they got a block team, and they got a team that plays third and fourth down, and their block team got mixed up there. So they can coach that up.
Schumacher from 25, and he missed it.
Wow. Rushed it a little bit. You know, ball was down, and he rushed it just a little bit.
Runnin Bulldogs drive the length of the field but miss a short field goal, and the shutout continues here in the third quarter. This week in the FWAA-NFF Super 16 poll, fans were treated to an 8-lateral finish in the Miami Duke game. That was nuts. But not a lot of movement in the poll. Ohio State off this past weekend remained number one. The biggest mover was number 9, Florida, up from the 12th spot after dismantling Georgia. Sorry, Coach. 27-3.
That game's over with. Fido.
Number 8, Notre Dame held off pesky Temple in a really good game, 24-20 at the link in Philly. There's Bradshaw on the end around, stays in bounds and gains a first down. Super 16 poll consists of FWAA writers, College Football Hall of Famers, NFF board members, and highly regarded collegiate administrators selected and created to create a balanced geographical perspective, as well as a diversity of viewpoints from the different roles associated within the game.
Pretty good poll, and as you mentioned, some really good, efficient voters.
You talking about yourself?
No, I'm not. They didn't ask me to vote. I can't pull those levers very good. I think the bottom line here, though, is we're going to find all this stuff out here in a couple of weeks. As we've seen today, some games are happening that affect it. And we're going to see the best four teams at the end of the year.
FBS has finally gone to a four-team playoff. This will be year two of that format. As Ross still in there in the second half, hits Jones into Bulldogs territory. The ball came out. Gardner Webb's got it. Second turnover forced by the Runnin Bulldogs defense as Havard recovered.
That's a real good learning experience there for Jones. After you get the ball in a pile, just go ahead and take it down. I mean, it's good job to keep the effort going, but let's watch him. Watch his delivery here. Look off by Ross, comes back to the backside. Good job of using your hands. And hey, you're getting ready to go down. Wrap it up. Collisions are happening. The ball is the most precious possession you'll ever have. Remember that, Evan?
Sure.
Not a lineman worth a 15-yard penalty. There's not a back or receiver worth a fumble.
For me, though, it's my spot chart. If I lost my spot chart, I wouldn't know what to do.
Okay. You do a good job with that chart. Hear about this screen, this quarterback draw? I've been waiting for that.
Yeah, you have. Maxwell to midfield.
You know, they've made some good adjustments at halftime, you know, with their offensive attack, showing a couple different ways to look at it. And defensively, you're up 29-0. They're putting some other guys in there. You're just playing bend and don't break. Make them earn it. Don't give them anything easy. Eventually, they're going to come off the edge once in a while with these edge guys to put a little pressure outside in. Here comes two of them.
Maxwell going down. Good to see Michael Billings back out there making plays.
You know, when you line up in a position as a quarterback, you got to estimate the defensive intent. Look at where the people are and what they can do from where they line up. Both the outside linebackers in that situation were in a position where they're going to come off the edge. You just can't go back there and hold the ball forever. I mean, your line can't protect the inside guys, and then you're getting the outside pressure. Good call there defensively by Coastal.
Only two down linemen on 3rd and 16. Another quarterback draw. Maxwell is going to be shy of the first down. Who is the best quarterback you ever coached in terms of reading the defense pre-snap?
You know, I've had a lot of good quarterbacks, but I think Troy Aikman obviously ended up being number one draft choice, but we went from the back to the wishbone after he broke his leg. I would say, as far as passing wise, Troy was. As far as option wise, Jamel Holloway was the best.
Sure.
And my own son, Todd Donnan, was outstanding at Marshall. You know, he was player of the year in the Southern Conference. Of course, he had a lot of help from his mother.
What was her primary advice?
Just don't let him hurt her baby. She got on the fans a lot more for getting on him than she did when they got on me. But that's.
Mother cares much more about son than husband. That's probably true wherever you look. 29-0, Coastal in front.
17. If your ad is signed by Chauncey, you just won a Chick-fil-A sandwich. If your prize, go by the Chick-fil-A concession tent, we'll get it on the East Concourse. For fans, we've got both men and women's basketball season tickets on sale now. We also have a hoopla mini pack. The deal's good for four great men's basketball games starting at just $20. The deal includes the December 2nd matchup against Auburn. And finally, the game for Ben Radford. How to go to CCPoopers.com/tickets.
Reminder,
we'll have a fireworks extravaganza immediately following today's game.
It's a gorgeous afternoon, early evening here in Conway, South Carolina. We remind you that Player of the Week voting opens Monday morning on AmericanSportsNet.com. And on the first play out of the break, a completed pass to the sideline. A bunch of guys in this game could be involved in potential awards, Big South and National. Angelo Henderson over 100 yards and a half with a couple of scores. Alex Ross, I mean, he's perfect except for that interception, which really wasn't totally his fault. Although he did throw it to the defender. So you could make a pretty good case it's on him. Chris Jones with a catch.
You know, it looks like just a routine play there to Chris Jones, but the way they launched their passing game is really impressive. That was what we call a catch and throw. I mean, the linemen are just blocking for one count there. He caught the ball and got rid of it in one motion, and a good route by, you know, Jones just pushing the defender off with a good takeoff and then stopping for the hitch.
Hop Henderson.
You know, if we could, you can call him Hop and I'll call him Skip, and then next week somebody call him Jump. All right, hop, skip, and jump. How about it?
Yeah, he's a triple jumper.
Yeah, we can. I knew he was a triple jumper. That's why we're going to add that to it. Track that we'll add that all to it. Here he comes, Hop.
This guy's had an incredible life. And here at Coastal, you know, Joe Mobley has said he was a borderline student when he came in, and he's, you know, really come on and put himself together. And he, more than anybody, as Tanner Burge lost his helmet. D'Angelo Henderson has appreciated the fact that Coastal hardly ever hits in practice anymore. That's a Joe Moglia specialty. His coaches thought he was nuts, but you know, he just wanted to keep guys healthy. And Henderson said, yeah, I really love that. I feel as fresh as ever. Ross looking long. What a throw. Touchdown. Bruce Mack.
We've been talking about this 3D coverage, and Matt did a little bit of stop and go on the outside, and really good job by Ross just laying it up there. And you know, he's been so effective all game long. I mean, I got to take him out though. I'm worried about his ankle for the rest of the playoffs. But you talked about being fresh. You know, when you're talking about playing 15 games, and that's what you got to do to win the national championship, and you start in August, you better be pretty fresh at the end of the year because you're playing against the best teams then. So we used to cut back practices, cut back hitting, just because the games take so much out of you. And the other thing that's different in the championship games is you can't dress out but 56 kids. So you're used to dressing out 76, you know, and using a lot more guys on special teams. I know we had to use We're always worried about who our second team punter was going to be. If a punter goes down, who our extra holder on the field goes, all those things. When you just got 56, that makes it tough.
Granger tacks on the extra point after a 55-yard score from Alex Ross to Bruce Mapp. Fifth touchdown of the season for the guy whose initials, the program motto, BAM.
I like it.
Bruce Allen Mapp, be a man. What a career he's having here in Conway. First score of the second half belongs to the Chanticleers. Mapp beat Allen deep.
Coastal Carolina strikes so fast. Five plays, 81 yards in 98 seconds.
We really like that route by Mapp. We talked about 3D coverage, but this is something you're good at. Tell us about this right here.
Well, AmericanSportsNet.com, your place for all sorts of college sports news. It's hockey season now, Coach. Big hockey fan?
Yeah, I like to watch it. I can't really tell you a lot about the intricacies of it, but I like it.
And we're just about 6 days away from college basketball beginning. All sorts of news, notes, highlights, and more on AmericanSportsNet.com.
Gardner Webb's been close to breaking one. You start putting in some extra guys on your kickoff team, a lot of times that happens.
Robert McCoy, the 25, and a flag down.
Robert McCoy with a kickoff return. Flags on the play.
Personal foul, block below the waist. Return team, number 51, 15-yard penalty, first down.
Penalties, penalties, and more penalties for Gardner Webb.
Five 15-yard penalties today, plus a pass interference that was debatable. I talked to Coach Overcash there at halftime. You know, his brother played center when I was at NC State. He's a supervisor of officials in the video replay today, and playing out of Wyoming, Oscar Overcash snapped the ball over the goalpost on that. We said that's one of the best snaps ever, you know, in that kind of setting, but. Really good player, but it, you know, it's hard to catch a snap when it goes over the goalpost.
That makes it difficult, yes. First and 10 from the 12-yard line, and, well, maybe back up five more.
False start, offense, number 85, 5-yard penalty, first down.
I was going to tell you about that 56-man roster. We were playing Eastern Kentucky, and our second-team punter had to go in because Brian Dowler, our first-team guy, got hurt. And the kid was real nervous, and he only kicked the ball about 16 yards. But what happened was they had too many men on the field, so we didn't have to punt. Well, we'll get back to it after this play. But
on first and 15, Maxwell keeps it. Lost the football. Coastal's got it. Looked like Shane Johnson dove on top. And it's gone from bad to worse for the guys from Boiling Springs.
Yeah, you feel for Maxwell. He's getting jacked up. A lot of good hits on him, and he got hit right as he's going down.
The field is a fumble and recovery by Coastal Carolina. The previous play is under review.
Woo, that's a good hit. We've got seven penalties now for 81 yards for Gardner Webb. But I was going to say, so we had the penalty, and he didn't have to kick, so it's the end of the game, and they're calling timeout, and we're getting ready to go to the national champion. Whoever wins this game is going to play for all the marbles. This is at Marshall, and it's 14. Let's get another look at this. Got to wrap it up.
He definitely lost it.
Yeah, I think that's pretty easy. So they call timeout, and we got a punt with like two minutes to go, and I go up to him, and I said, look. I said, you got a six. He's a little bit down. I don't blame him. He's had a pretty good game today, not a lot of help, but, you know, fumbles happen once in a while. So I said to the kid, I said, look, if you'll just kick the ball.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. First down.
He said to the kid.
I said, if you'll just kick it twice as far as you did the last time, I'll be happy, because he'd kicked it 16.
And what did he do?
So he ended up, and the ball didn't hardly get over the line of scrimmage. If they'd have held, if anybody would have held their hands up, it'd have been knocked down. But it rolled about 40 yards. So it ended up being about a 42-yard punt, and everybody gave him a standing ovation. The guy couldn't even breathe. It was so tough on him to have to go in there and kick like that.
And he ended up winning the game.
Yeah, we won. Had to have standing ovation for him, though.
Backup quarterback Michael Church throws to the end zone, and it was tipped incomplete.
These guys are going for the throat. I mean, they're not holding back any. They're looking at these rankings, 36-0. They do have Michael Church in, and we heard a lot of good things about him. He's a senior as well from Kannapolis, North Carolina, one of the only unincorporated towns in America. You didn't know that, did you?
No, and I've been there, and I didn't know that.
Exactly, you know, unless they incorporated since I left.
What does that mean?
That means it's not corporated.
Thank you. Here's Abercrombie. And he will gain a couple. I wanted to ask you, you know.
Google that and figure it out for me.
I will.
All right.
I wanted to ask you.
Their nickname, though, is Kannapolis Little Wonders.
Sure. Home of the Intimidators of the South Atlantic League.
All right. Let's go on with it. We got a lot of stuff here to go over, but right now this game's got to get going a little bit better. We got Abercrombie back in there. He's already got a touchdown and a two-point play.
He scored the first 8 points of the game. There's Church. 1-0 is a starter in his career. He beat VMI a couple years ago. Church slings one to the perimeter, and it's caught. That's Frankie Richardson with his first reception of the game, first and goal.
Good job by Frankie coming back to the ball and using his body as a shield there to help him. You know, we just saw Gardner Webb try to play press man, and the guy ran right by him, and that time they lined up off of him, and they threw it in front of him. So they're getting them about any way you can. And here comes Abercrombie.
O.J. Mal leading a host of white jersey defenders.
And so have you ever had that name before, Oshamar?
No, first Oshamar.
That's an interesting name, and it's very, you know, makes you think the guy's going to be really wealthy. I mean, he's got an unbelievable, he's got the great name for going into pro football.
Sounds like a designer.
That's what I'm saying.
And he's got a second touchdown.
And then baby Oshamar.
Maybe one of your grandkids will be named Oshamar one day.
I'm going to bring that up. But seriously, right now for Gardner Webb, this is a lot better team for the fans watching and what we're seeing. And they came out with a real vengeance there in the second half. A great drive, and then they get the air blown out with a missed field goal. And then since then, nothing's happened for them. I hate this for Coach McCray and his kids because they're a better football team than this. But they're getting a team that's going to be in the top in the country, and they're playing them on their home field. And when they're playing like they're, you know, got to make the playoffs, and they're playing extremely well.
So certainly a vengeful performance from Coastal Carolina today. And, you know, this is a Gardner Webb team that beat Liberty at home. Charleston Southern waxed them pretty good, but now it's possible that Coastal Carolina and Charleston Southern are worthy of byes in the tournament. Those could be two of the top eight teams in the country.
Yeah, I agree with you. We can talk a little bit about D'Angelo Henderson, and we've got all kind of nicknames for him today, but I didn't realize he had that kind of style in his hair either. But any way you look at it, this young man with over 100 yards, 15 career times, and also 23 consecutive games with a touchdown, now it's up to 24. This guy is the real deal. And what I like about him, the only thing, first of all, I didn't like is his pass protection. He puts his head down. But everything else, he's really good at feeling the pressure and breaking to the outside, running tough inside, protects the ball. And he's got a good guy behind him. If he doesn't play hard, his backup, Oshamar Abercrombie, is going to come in. I had to say that one more time.
Henderson, the epitome of a Coke impact player, and more great kick coverage from Coastal.
Well, we're in a situation here now with Coach McCray, his staff, his players. You got too much pride here to, you just got to understand that we got a quarter to go. Let's go out there and try to cut down on these penalties. Don't stop ourselves. Let's see if they make a move here and put somebody else in at quarterback.
That's exactly what they've done. The day is apparently over for Tyrell Maxwell. He was 4-for-13 for 90 yards, 18 rushes for 50 yards. But now Brody Rollins is into the game.
But he's had some negative yardage plays. He had a lot more yardage than that rushing. How much did he lose?
A bunch.
Yeah, I think that's the real stat. That's one thing I'd like to jump on everybody in college football. Let's take the rushing yardage that you lose, particularly in passing situations, off of the pass, like they do in the pros, like they do against your Patriots. When Brady gets sacked, he doesn't lose yardage on his running game. How about those Patriots? You think they got a chance this year?
You know, they're doing all right, but one game at a time.
Just got to get.
They're on to Washington.
Just got to get a coach. I mean, come on, the guys, you'd think he'd finally learned how to win after all these years.
Well, if you had tutored him like Bill Parcells had asked you to, maybe he would do a little bit better.
Yeah, that'd have been a big benefit for him.
Timeout called by Gardner Webb. You were telling me a great story this morning about Coach Parcells calling you and offering you a job, and he really wanted you to work with Bill Belichick, who was a young coach that he liked a lot.
Yeah, the whole point was, and Bill and I laugh about it now, Parcells and Belichick, was that, you know, Bill Belichick was a valuable asset to Parcells as a defensive coordinator. But before the fact that he was an actual full-time coach, he was a guy behind the scenes, breaking down films, helping organize practice, running the scout team, was a kind of a part-time coach. And Bill saw the value in him and wanted him to be a full-time coach. And one of the things he talked to me about when I was offered a job was to come up there and work with the staff and also help develop some of these younger guys. And one of them was Bill Belichick. And I told Belichick several times, you did all right without me helping you, that's for sure.
Brody Rollins back in the shotgun, and the give to Bobby Clark, and he's near the first down marker. You've been in coaching for 38 years, championships, bowl victories. When you look at what Bill Belichick has done and just his day-to-day style, what stands out to you about the way he goes about his business?
Just consistency. And in the era of free agency, when everybody's team changes every year, no matter who he's got, they look like a competitive team. no, you know, injuries, whatever happens. I mean, this team just takes care of business week in and week out. Of course, he's got a premier quarterback that helps him, but, you know, they lost two great corners last year that left in free agency, and that's the thing that fans don't understand. You know, you can develop your team, but you also try to develop these underneath guys so they're ready to step in. Then they look good in preseason, and these other teams see them on tape, and then they offer them a big contract. And so it's hard to get second-team guys, and Coach McCray's still fighting them and trying to keep them going out here and try to pick up a first down.
Blackman, no gain.
The biggest thing that I've come away with this Coastal defense today is just the fact that they've really played good technique. They're where they're supposed to be. Coach Carlin's got them lined up. They're tackling well. They're slow playing everything and making sure that the quarterbacks have to hold on the ball just a little bit longer, and then that lets the underneath coverage and the pursuit get to it. You see a lot of green jerseys, a lot of black jerseys around the ball. What color are those now? I can't even see that far out there.
Black with a teal trim.
Okay, that's
perhaps
good. Black and green. That's good. There we go.
Kerry Bernard carried a defender for a strong 9-yard gain and a first down.
Well, let's coach them up here for the fourth quarter. And you're telling these guys that haven't been playing a lot, here's a chance for you to get on tape. Let me see you wait for an opportunity. I don't care what the score is. Play with some pride. Go out there and show me what your potential is. And that's what the role of both teams should be here in this fourth quarter.
That was just the second third down conversion for Gardner Webb today. The Runnin Bulldogs 2-for-10 on third downs. Three down and one to go. It's all Coastal. Chanticleers are happy at home. When D'Angelo Henderson was about 8 years old, he started playing football, and one day he was running down the sidelines. He ran for 97 yards and a touchdown, and he said how the thing he noticed, his mom was running on the sidelines with him as he scored a touchdown. Today, his mom's just a spectator. She's seen him score twice.
Well, he scored every way possible. Here's the option, really good blocking downfield, and you called him Hop. That's a good, really good nickname for him, and this guy's got 114 yards. Probably could have more, but we've seen his backup go in and do a good job, particularly around the goal line, score two touchdowns in a two-point play. When you got two backs like this and a quarterback that can operate and a big old strong offensive line, good wide receivers, you got a lot of different elements that make it very difficult to defend.
Rhodey Rollins. Cross midfield.
Look like Rollins is going to throw that left-handed. I like that.
If an NFL coach called you this week, and I know that happens from time to time, and asked you, what do you think about D'Angelo Henderson as a pro prospect? What kind of back is he? What would you tell him?
Yeah, I would think, you know, size is going to limit him a little bit, but the game in NFL right now is such a space game. You know, there's room for a guy like him, particularly with his quickness. I didn't get to see him catch the ball a lot tonight, but I would say if he improves his pass protection, he's going to definitely get a shot.
Is pass protection sometimes a thing that'll hold those explosive backs?
I mean, it makes a difference maybe in a couple rounds or being a first, you know, but I'm just talking about that's not why he's playing right now, but he can learn how to keep his head up, move his feet. Very seldom is he asked to pass protect because they do these catch and throw things, but, you know, I'm picking straws here. I mean, I would say overall, I wouldn't want somebody to say, hey, well, the coach is getting on you on that. This is a tremendous player. Very high on him, and I think he's got a good future. And if he can't play in the NFL, I guarantee he can play in Canada.
Rhodey Rollins, option quarterback in high school. Very shifty, and he's showing that a little bit. Rollins got the start in a win over Virginia Union back in September. And Shana clears down in the field. That's why the clock stopped.
You just don't know if Price is cramped up or what it is. He seems to be very immobile right here. All right. You know, for a lot of the fans, you know, you get to watch South Carolina and Clemson and these SEC and ACC teams, but college football means just as much to these young men at this level, and there's a lot of good coaching and talent. But even the guys that aren't the all-stars, being on a college team is going to help them the rest of their life because they learn teamwork and they learn what it's like to sacrifice. And boy, you're just impressed with both these teams and the character that they possess.
Well, if Joe Moglia was upset about one thing more than anything last week, it was just the defensive effort, the number of breakdowns. Kelvin DeVoe, a guy who was benched at the start of this game. Austin Murillo replaced him. But Coastal Carolina's defense has just showed relentless and aggressive pursuit throughout this game.
Yeah, good preparation. They knew they were going to play a guy that could beat him with his legs, and they wanted to make sure that they would force him to be a passer, and they really locked onto the routes, and they never did hit but one deep throw on them the whole game. So they did a good job of taking away their best stuff, and they, as you mentioned, tackled extremely well.
And right there, Bernard gains two. It'll be third and a long six.
The one thing that the Runnin Bulldogs got to work on is this field pressure and this sideline pressure where teams that run this 4-2 look bring people off the edge because they're getting caught from the backside a lot. And if that's happening, then you really need to have some kind of naked bootleg or some kind of action away from that because every time that Coastal's run it, they've gotten them from the backside.
Gardner Webb 2-for-10 on third down.
Good spin by Rollins there.
Rhodey Rollins on the quarterback keeper.
Setting up a big fourth and two here. Like to see him put Rollins on the edge here and see if he can run or pass.
They're going to go for it.
Here comes that edge pressure again. Let's see if they catch him from behind.
Coastal's defense again.
Backside pressure, just too much for him.
You got to feel pretty helpless right now if you're on the Runnin Bulldogs.
Well, just by alignment there, you get hurt when you don't have anybody chipping off that guy, either a tackle going out there or putting a man in motion to chip him, because if you're in a one-back set, and you shipped your other guy out, somebody's got to block that guy, and just ended up unblocked and made the play. And we're going to take a break here and come back. Let's watch some of these younger guys play here. All you people, stay with us here on the American Sports Network.
TCUSports.com/tickets. During next week's game against Kennesaw State, the score is zero in trash. Please recycle or compost your trash with the TCU Green Team and help us get this zero waste. Look for more information this week online.
Coastal Carolina was knocked from the ranks of the unbeatens last week, but they have bounced back well today. And you could argue that the Charleston Southern Buccaneers were robbed. I think Austin Brown had a pretty good case, but it was Kyle Diener from Colgate, Red Raider from upstate New York, the FCS Player of the Week, as voted on AmericanSportsNet.com. You know, Coastal Carolina unbeaten no more. There are only three undefeated teams in FCS coming into today. Harvard and Dayton both stayed unbeaten, but come from behind wins against their respective opponents. The third undefeated team's McNeese State. They've got a big game tonight against 6-2 Sam Houston State at 7 o'clock.
You know, those Ivy League teams have got some good players, too. When we were at Marshall, we played Brown, and I promise you, you know, our players thought it was going to be one of those cakewalks, and they were, besides being athletic, very cerebral. They had some really good schemes.
That's what you would expect, right?
Well, I mean, you know, I'm just saying, though, they didn't beat themselves. They did a good job of orchestrating their different looks, and we're seeing these signals over on the sideline, and usually what you got one dummy guy and two live, or sometimes you got one guy signaling to the receivers, one to the line, one to the quarterback. But a lot of different looks over there. Hard to steal those signals.
That's Michael Church.
Michael Church on the quarterback keeper.
Michael got a little stinger there, too. He thought he was going to break one.
Coach, one thing I wanted to ask you before, when you were at Marshall, it's an 11-game season, but you would always play 14 or 15 games. Did you plan for that? Did you expect to have 15 games at the start of the season, and how did you go about your business differently?
Well, we had a pretty good tradition there, but we just, as the season progressed, after about the sixth or seventh game, we started cutting back our practices a little bit, and we also never went out in full pads after that because we felt like we'd had so much contact at that point we needed to be fresh. The other thing we did, we tried to substitute a little bit more, even in the tight games, to keep our guys fresh, and then understanding that we're going to have a four-game tournament to win all the marbles. So One of the things you always want to have in a coach, and I'm not just saying about me, but any coach, number one is how do you handle pressure? Because you're going to have it the rest of your life if you're a coach. And number two, ability to look into the future. What do you do when you're making these plans? It's like Coach Mowgli is making plans now for his next move into the, you know, FBS. And so take a player and develop him. How's he going to be down the road? Look for problems that might be coming up. So that's what you need to look for in coaching, how guys handle pressure and what they do as far as looking into the future.
Yeah, and the roll, that was a 51-yard punt and no return all the way to the 15-yard line. Coastal Carolina on the verge of being 8-1 on the season.
Number 8, Coastal Carolina, still in front, 43-0. Next game on ASN, the Colonial Athletic Association matchup, Towson and Maine from Orono. Towson looking for its fourth straight win. Meanwhile, the Runnin Bulldogs from their own 15-yard line gain 7. Now, Coastal Carolina coach shut out Alabama A&M in their first game in October, I should say, 55-0. If Coastal Carolina can keep Gardner Webb off the board, it'll be the first time in program history that with back-to-back or with two shutouts in the same season.
Impressive, and you know, I had no idea that this was going to be this kind of blowout based on watching the tape of both teams, but too many mistakes by Gardner Webb early. Just couldn't get anything going, and you know, just like that play right there, even though you got your second teamers in. Routine pass just a little high, but the one thing I'll give you a little love on there, Evan, boy, you're an encyclopedia of knowledge on this FCS stuff. You got this whole thing down, man. I mean, I tried to prep for these teams, but you're talking about the Black Bears of Maine. That's pretty impressive.
Coach, I knew I had to do my homework to, you know, be on your playing field.
Hey,
you got.
I don't know about that. As far as this knowledge of FCS, though, Towson had a really good running back a couple years ago. I remember seeing him in the playoffs. He did a good job.
Rollins on the move. And it looked like he was throwing it away, and then
it did. That was a good play.
Estes with a catch.
You know, Estes made a couple nice catches tonight. He caught the long bomb there from Maxwell, and then that one right there looked like it was just throwing it out of bounds, but highest point, you know, like a basketball throw.
And Estes was a very good basketball player in high school. Thought about trying to play basketball as well at
Gardner Webb. You know, Estes is a huge Antonio Gates fan. You can sort of see it. Swing it out to the right side. Ooh, good quickness there shown by Elijah Perry.
Wrong pass complete to Elijah Perry.
You know, so many of these football players that we hear about playing at whatever level, people don't realize how good intramural basketball is at these different places. We had Champ Bailey one night. I went over to watch some intramurals play at Georgia, and he got 36 points. I mean, he could have helped our varsity, but every one of these kids is that kind of – you just don't see guys playing both sports much anymore, but I'm sure Estes would be a good college basketball player too.
Flags come out. Pass complete to Adonis Lee.
Flag on the play.
Estes.
Did not set. 5 yard penalty. First down.
The eighth penalty for Gardner Webb.
And they've had some of them declined. I mean, just atypical of their team. You don't expect that. But anytime you get these second team, third team guys in, you know, they get a little excited. And the amount of penalties they've had on first down on offense and lost yardage plays on offense on first down have negated a running football team, because they've been first and 15, second 17 several times tonight.
Perry up the sideline, but he stepped out of bounds, close to the line of scrimmage.
You know, people ask me all the time, why do you run the option into the boundary when he doesn't look like you have much field? And the reason people do that is the most teams will cover the field a lot more than they will into the boundary. Sometimes you have a half a man advantage there. And if you get an early enough pitch, you can get the ball down the boundary. But at that time, a really good job again of stringing it out by Coastal, and really the boundary helped their defense.
Rollins looking long.
Estes, come up with it.
There's a flag coming up. Austin Murillo will likely be penalized for Coastal.
There's another
pass interference. Defense, number 22. Penalty, automatic first down.
I like to see a spot foul in college football when you throw the ball 30 yards down the field and only get penalized 15. I mean, this guy's going to catch that ball for a big game. I'd like to see that change where, you know, spot foul, but probably won't happen in my lifetime. Might happen in yours, Kevin. Evan, you're only 30, so there's a good chance it'll happen in the next 40 years.
What other changes would you like to see in college football, Coach?
Well, I like the fact their stipend. They're starting to give the kids some money. I think that's good. I'd like to
start offense, number 74, 5 yard penalty, first down.
Got some new linemen in there. Here we go. First and 15. They're getting used to doing that. But, you know, I think I'd like to see them have an 18 playoff, just because I think there's that many good teams. You got 69 or so playing basketball for all of them. So, that's a bunch of hogwash about missing class. I mean, our golf team this week was out at school 5 days. They were playing over Atlanta, and then they went out to the West Coast. College football on any level doesn't miss hardly any school.
There's a good hit. A linebacking core, Shane Johnson, has been a very active playmaker for the defense today.
Yeah, the other thing I'd like to see as far as the power schools is hey, you have the power schools under one situation and the non-power under other, and hey, let them go for it. You know, Katie, bar the door, whatever you need to do, go ahead and do it, because you got the power to do it and you got the money to do it.
Gardner Webb's going to fall to 2-3 in the Big South Conference. I mean, we mentioned it at the top. A year ago, the Runnin Bulldogs were winless through the Big South. So to go through October with a couple of wins, beating Liberty at home, Presbyterian on the road last week, there's a program that, you know, gradually moving in the right direction under Carroll McRae.
Took a little bit of a step back tonight because of their not because they got beaten soundly, just because of their own mistakes. To win a game like this, you got to play your best shot, but you also got to keep away from things like this, lost yardage plays, penalties, fumbles, turnovers, and they needed a really, the same kind of game they got from their opponent, they needed to have something close to that to have a shot, but pretty much outmanned for the most part.
Rollins realizing that sometimes playing quarterback isn't as glorious as it's made out to be.
Yeah, you know, on the night now, we talked about penalties, but that's four sacks and also nine tackles for loss. So you've had 13 plays and six offensive penalties. You've had 19 plays that are negative, you know, and it's just hard to create a lot of positive stuff out of that. And they're going to be in trouble here.
He was almost tackled by his teammates. He got tripped up and
Jesse
then
June on
didn't
the
have
return.
Really anywhere to go. Jesse June gets it out to the 30.
Now that's a good name, Jesse June. I like it.
Coastal Carolina, number 8 in the country. A performance like this should move them up.
I wish we had a telestrator.
Around the
big everybody South. Heard that. I wish we had a telestrator. I didn't mean to, I didn't know we were coming back right then, but.
Well, next year, Coach, next year.
Yeah, we'll be all right. That's all I want for Christmas is a telestrator.
Presbyterian leading Liberty 13-7 in Lynchburg. That would be a surprise.
It really would.
If the Flames went down there.
You know, I watched, I had Presbyterian earlier this year when they played Charlotte and got some pretty good young players, and
they play hard.
Tommy Spangler, defensive coordinator, used to be the head coach. Now he's the defensive coordinator, and they got a good sense of direction there. The Blue Hose, and the one thing I always remember about the Blue Hose that I will never forget: the first college game I ever saw was PC against I've already forgot who they were playing, Newberry, when I was 7 years old. So I'll always remember that first game. And I was asking. Here we go. Is that June?
That's Taylor Bagley.
I thought that might be our boy June there. Hey, Bagley, good job.
That's just his second catch of the season. And obviously a career long. His first catch was for 10 yards.
But I couldn't understand when I went to the game why I wasn't wearing the uniform, because I expected to play. We were going to the game. My granddaddy said, where's my uniform? I'm going in.
You didn't realize you were just there to watch.
No, I mean, I thought I was going to play. I was ready to go.
Gardner Webb could have used you tonight.
I don't know about that. I think Gardner Webb, to me, this is not typical of their team, and I would say if I thought otherwise, but from what I've seen on tape, there's a lot better team than they've shown tonight.
After a catch and run for Bagley. That was Kenneth Daniels brought down from behind at the six.
You know, part of the deal, I mean, Coach Mugley is putting it, he's got a lot of guys in there. We don't even know their numbers here. Part of your deal as a defensive team, you got to try to stop them, too. They're not trying to run the score up. I mean, a little surprised they did throw the one pass. But, you know, your job as a second-team player is to get out there and stop them just like the first-team guys do.
If you don't stop them here, Coastal's going to hang half a 100 on Gardner Webb. Daniels, he's really running hard in these final minutes. He didn't get a chance to play very often. He's trying to take advantage of it. He would love to get in the end zone.
I like to see him just fall on the ball here. You can run the clock out, fall on the ball. Snap it back there and fall on it.
Church gave it to Daniels and he goes nowhere. So Coastal next week has Kennesaw State at home. The brand new program led by Brian Bohannon that's been very frisky in its first full season.
You know, Brian's a good young coach. They're running the version of Paul Johnson's offense, three-back set. The big, different type of attack they're going to see. This three-back option, they run that shoe-shine type blocks where they really block you low, try to cut your legs at the point of attack and backside. And they're going to have a good week of preparation. Their scout team needs to get in there and give them some good looks.
It's third down. Daniels.
Good pursuit.
Does not get to the goal line.
Like that effort there defensively. That's the way to hold them out.
And then after next Saturday, Coach, this Coastal team goes up to Lynchburg to play the Liberty Flames on Thursday night.
Well, you know, Liberty, as you mentioned, how much time did they go in that game?
There's about 6 minutes when we last checked.
That would be a huge move by PC to get that win. What, they got an extra play here? Please don't kick a field goal.
This is the backup kicker, Caleb Kelly. 19-yard field goal is right down the middle. Coach is speechless, and that doesn't happen very often.
You know, that's not my role to decide what people do, but you know, usually in coach speak, when you got the ball and you got a 43-point lead, just fall on the ball. But he's letting his second team guy kick it. You know, every coach has got to do what they feel like, you know, with your program. So I'll never second guess anybody. But shoe was on the other foot. He would probably like for that guy to fall on the ball. Wouldn't you think, Evan?
You know, it's a tough spot. I understand both sides of it.
I mean, what do you understand when it's 43? Now, how does that 3 points help your team? And I mean, when the game's over? I mean, I can argue a lot of different things, but these kids have played hard. I understand it, but part of the role of both teams is just go out there and compete. And I mentioned that I took up for Coastal saying that it is the defense's role to stop them. You know, I said that before they got down there. But once you get inside the 10, less than 2 minutes, you usually fall on the ball.
Well, they couldn't have run out the clock. They would have had to give Gardner Webb the ball back if they didn't score, barring a penalty.
That would have been the end of the world if they gave the ball back to him.
All day long, the kickoff coverage has been superb, just like about every other aspect of the Chanticleer's game today.
Had a really good game. They did a tremendous job. Well-prepared team, well-coached team that knows how to take advantage of what their abilities are. Got an outstanding quarterback, good backs. Defensively, they played a lot better tonight. than what we'd seen. You saw him last week. Didn't you think they made a lot of improvement?
It wasn't even close. It really wasn't. And it was a couple scheme changes that you noticed, the way they aligned their safeties. But it was mostly aggressiveness, confidence, and just making plays when they had a chance to make them. Making tackles.
Yeah, well, you got a chance to make a play. We talked about it early. A lot of missed tackles early by GW, plus the fact they missed some, had some big penalties in clutch situations. And it's just one of those very much outplayed tonight.
Rollins makes a man miss and throws short. This Coastal team will stay in the top 10 for the 26th consecutive week. Number 8 right now in both polls. If they win their last two games, there's no doubt at 10-1 they'd be in the playoffs. If they lost either to Kennesaw State or to Liberty, then they would have to sit and wait nervously. And Coach, your Thundering Herd team was usually pretty much a lock to make the bracket, but it was always a little nerve-wracking as that tip pass gets caught.
Yeah, it's always, you're waiting around to hear the vote and hear where you're played. The biggest thing is scheduling, you know, where you play and who you, you know, not only where you play, but the bracket. You know, a lot of times you can be a really good team and you really don't know what's going on with the other teams in your bracket. And all of a sudden there's like three great teams and two of them are going to be in one bracket and one of them in the other. That scheduling and the bracketing has a lot to say about it.
You've been around college football for a long time. Joe Mowgli is a different character than a lot of football coaches. You had a chance to interact with him this week. Aside from the performance, obviously a convincing win, what were your impressions of Joe Mowgli?
Yeah, I think he's got a well orchestrated team, and they do an outstanding job of getting his team ready. And he's got a good plan here. They're going to really make a statement when they go into the new conference next year.
Joe Mowgli will walk off with his 40th win as head coach of the Chanticleers. He's the fastest to 40 in Big South history. From the very beginning to the final bell, this was domination. A couple lucky plays, but there was no fortune that could have helped the Runnin Bulldogs today. Final score, Coastal 46, Gardner Webb nothing. For my broadcast partner, Jim Donnan, this is Evan Leppler saying so long from Conway. This has been a production of the American Sports Network.